Good morning, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Palo Alto, where we come to transform ourselves and each other and the world. It is good to be together. You are welcome to keep your video on throughout the service. It's nice to see one another if you're comfortable with that. We'll mostly keep our audio off, but let's all unmute for a few moments right now to say hello. Good morning.
Good morning.
We are very glad to have Nancy Neff here to tell us about our justice partner. Nancy is a church member and a volunteer coordinator and board member with California Clean Money Campaign.
Good morning, all. The California Clean Money Campaign is dedicated to the creation of an open and accountable government that is responsive to the needs of all Californians. We suspect that money in politics has something to do with why we don't have that yet. Our biggest success has been passing the California Disclose Act so that voters can see who really pays for political ads. And we have since expanded it with the text message, the social media, and the petition Disclose Acts. Currently, we are working to pass the Ballot Disclose Act, which would require that a short list of supporters and opponents of each ballot measure be printed on the ballot itself. The Ballot Disclose Act does not yet have the support of a critical person, the chair of the Assembly Elections Committee, who happens to be our local assembly member, Mark Berman. Get in touch with me if you want to help gain his support. UUCPA has actually played a critical role in the success of California Clean Money Campaign. Thanks to your support, especially the use of space, we are the home of the strongest local action group in the state. Clean Money Campaign relies for success on the volunteers who attend hearings in Sacramento or on Zoom currently, and our email list of over 100,000 people who are responsive when we need to flood a legislator with emails and calls. If you are not on this elite list, please go to yesfairelections.org and sign up. Your donations make it possible to maintain our email list and our small staff. A special thank you to those of you who are monthly donors. We rely entirely on individual donations, plus one small family foundation, and our average donation last year was $28. Speaking of donations, in lieu of a big mailing party this year, let me know if you can do a small share of our end-of-year mailing at home. Thank you very much for supporting California Clean Money Campaign in its efforts to make democracy work for the people.
You can see the order of service by following the link in the chat, and right there you will see much more about how to find out more about California Clean Money, including how to get in touch with Nancy, how to get in touch with Mark Berman. Please also take note of the important town hall meetings coming up and the other announcements listed at the beginning of the order of service. COVID or no COVID, there is a lot going on here at UUCPA, and I don't want you to miss anything. And now, let us begin our service. A flame is always changing. Although it appears very much the same, moment to moment, it reminds us that change is constant and that the only moment that is completely real is this one. And so we light our chalice with the words of botanist and writer Robin Wall Kimmerer. If there is meaning in the past and the imagined future, it is captured in the moment. When you have all the time in the world, you can spend it not on going somewhere, but on being where you are.
With our centering words each week, we draw on the many sources of our living tradition. Today's words are from the U.S. poet Jan Richardson. They're longer than usual because today's service is about exactly this part of the service, the centering. And we want to give you time to think about what it means to you. Jan Richardson's poem is called Prepare. Strange how one word will so hollow you out. But this word has been in the wilderness for months, years. This word is what remained after everything else was worn away by sand and stone. It is what withstood the glaring of sun by day, the weeping loneliness of the moon at night. Now it comes to you, racing out of the wild, eyes blazing and waving its arms, its voice ragged with desert, but piercing and loud as it speaks itself again and again. Prepare, prepare. It may feel like the word is leveling you, emptying you as it asks you to give up what you have known. It is impolite and hardly tame, but when it falls upon your lips, you will wonder at the sweetness, like honey that finds its way into the hunger you had not known was there. And now, as we follow the sound of the bell into silence, let's become centered and fully present in this place together. Please join in as Bruce leads us in singing Return Again.
Return to who you are, return.
We now turn our thoughts to the important events of our lives which we wish this community to share. If you have a joy or a sorrow you would like me to speak this morning, please send your joys and sorrows to joyconcern@uucpa.org or post them in the chat box provided by Zoom, and they will be shared aloud. So many joys and sorrows today, and always there are many more that have not been voiced. I have a few to share as well before we go into our silence. And that is that Lulu, the church dog, Jeff Cashdeller's dog, died this week. Jeff is very sad, as you can imagine, and a lot of other folks are going to be missing Lulu as well. And I want to remind everybody of two memorial services coming up next weekend. On Saturday, December 11th at 10 a.m., we have the celebration of the life of Nancy Westerfield here in the main hall. And on Sunday, December 12th, we have the celebration of life of June Bridges. Always summery and sunny, another June birthday like myself. June's memorial service will be held at 2. Both are here in the main hall, observing all of our COVID restrictions, of course. Let us now take a few moments of silent prayer or meditation to hold all that we've heard with compassion, with care for one another, with gratitude that we share this life. Blessed be. Please join in as Bruce leads us in singing, Voice Still and Small.
Good morning again. I'm Richard Heydt. When I was a research scientist at SRI, which was until just before the pandemic began, some of the most interesting work that I did was in experimental acoustics. I've been fascinated by sound and by hearing perception for many years, and the idea of silence I find interesting in itself. I spent many, many hours working in an acoustic anechoic chamber. And for those of you that don't know what, you may have seen the rooms which have the big foam wedges in them. That's an anechoic chamber. I spent many hours in one of those. And in an anechoic chamber, not only are the sounds from the outside blocked from coming in, but sounds that you might make inside are absorbed by those foam wedges. So an anechoic chamber is an almost completely non-reverberant environment. And to many people, probably most people, it feels quite strange the first time you step in an anechoic space. It almost feels dead. Which is a word that people commonly think of when they step into an anechoic space. But after you're accustomed to it, it's wonderfully quiet. And I'll admit that on some really stressful days at work, I would go into this anechoic chamber just to calm myself down. And sometimes I'd even turn the lights off, which made it even better. I also spent a lot of time measuring and predicting and analyzing what people would hear and what they would not hear in different types of sound environments. Early on, I was doing work in electronic noise cancellation, which at least in principle is straightforward. If you picture sound as a wave with peaks and troughs, then you can imagine that if I make another wave, which also has peaks and troughs, and I make that wave a shift at 180 degrees out of phase, when you add those two waves together, they cancel each other out. So in principle, that sound that you were hearing goes away. And I stress, in principle. And of course, it's much harder than that for a lot of different technical reasons, as well as for some psychoacoustic reasons. Now, a common goal of noise cancellation is to produce quiet. There might be an annoying and repetitive loud sound, like the sound of a motor bearing that's going bad, and it drives you nuts. Cyclic sounds and repetitive sounds are often the most straightforward types of sounds to work with. So you're smart, you build a system to cancel that noise. And lo and behold, you find the system works great and the sound goes away. So you want to pat yourself on the back and you're all ready to enjoy that quiet that you know you deserve, but then you find that by getting rid of that annoying motor sound, you actually exposed an entirely different sound that was being masked by the motor. Now you hear the dog barking, and you go, oops. So lesson number one is there's always another sound beneath the one you are listening to. Another point of this example is that what you perceive of as quiet is both relative and subjective. You might care about the noise from the barking dog, but on the other hand, you don't care about the sound of the wind, for example. And after a short time, you don't even notice the wind, or you even find it soothing. Hearing depends not only on the physical mechanisms your ear uses to transduce sound waves into sound perception. It also depends on your brain. That's psychoacoustics. A related point is that if your goal is to reduce noise in the pursuit of quiet, then what you care about most are the sounds that get your attention. Like in my example, the motor bearing or the barking dog. I did many listening experiments with people to illuminate that very issue. What is it that gets your attention when you're in an environment with sound, which is pretty much any environment you're in? What is it that gets your attention? Now, what do my words about sound, silence, quiet, and attention have to do with today's service? Well, our service is about centering. And one way that we center ourselves at the beginning of the service is to listen to the bell. Some people don't particularly like the sound of the bell, but many more do. I do. I like it a lot. And if you're one of those people like me, think, what is it that draws you to the sound of the bell? What is it in that sound that you attend to? Is it the clear tones? Is it the slow resonance that rolls in and out? Is it the sounds? Or is it the silences between them as the bell rings? What images do you place on those tones and silences? And finally, remember that there's always something to be heard beneath the silence.
Our reading comes from the potter and poet, M.C. Richards. In centering the clay on the potter's wheel, one centers down, yes, and then one immediately centers up, down and up, wide and narrow, letting focus bear within it an expanded consciousness, and letting a widened awareness have the commitment to detail of a focused attention. Not either or, but both and. You can perhaps feel the inner movement of a centering consciousness that plays dynamically in the tides of inner and outer, self and other, in an instinctive hope toward wholeness. Center and centered have come to be fairly widely used. They tend to imply a connection with the navel, with one-pointedness on the way to bliss, realization, and inner peace. But these are not the goals of the centering process, for it is a continual engagement with experience, not a withdrawal from it. It begins with pain and ends with paradox. It wrestles with evil and the demonic as it does with angels and repentance. It is an activity of consciousness, not a stage of spiritual achievement. I have found that centering, like clay, bears the future within it, for it contains a space for ongoing development and differentiation. In other words, it proves to be an open image, a vessel holding a content that is life itself.
Suffer from memory.
Centering is the first thing that a potter needs to do before it is possible to turn the clay into a vessel. If clay is not centered on the spinning wheel, you will get only chaos when you try to draw up the walls, make a vase or a bowl or a plate. So the first thing that a potter does, take this lump of clay, put it as close as possible to the center, set the wheel spinning, and then with elbows braced firmly on their thighs and hands braced firmly around the clay, the potter seeks to center that clay. It's important to be braced because the clay resists. There are forces that make the clay want to move off in this direction or that. And of course, it isn't a perfectly symmetrical piece of this malleable stone dug from the earth. It's got lumps and bumps, and they press against the hands, trying to move the potter from their steadiness. And just as Mary Caroline Richards describes, the potter brings their hands together so the clay thins and rises, and then presses down, bringing it down and wider, over and over again, doing that to compress the clay, make all of its particles as tightly together as possible, but but also always with that steady centering. Until the clay is centered, nothing else can happen. I had heard that this term was also used in dance, ballet, I thought. But I don't know anything about ballet, so I got in touch with somebody who does. A professional ballet dancer of our acquaintance, Miranda Defoe, who is the daughter of Veronica Agronoff Defoe, our wonderful pianist, whom we've already heard today. And I texted Miranda and said, is this a term with ballet? And she said, it's not a formal term, but she knew just what I meant when I said what this service was about. She said, it's essential for us as dancers to be centered physically. Well, that didn't surprise me at all. Of course you have to be centered before you can leap and spin and rise up on your very, very tips of your toes. But she also said, physically and mentally, in order to dance. And that spoke to me also of what we do here in the service, that we are centering not only by being still in our bodies, physically, like the clay is centered on the wheel, but mentally, emotionally, spiritually, trying to find that stillness. Without it, a dancer can't dance. And with it, she can do marvelous things. It's that focus of attention, even as one's vision is wider, as Richards says, and as we saw right there in our opening piece by Veronica, the kind of concentration that allows a pianist to keep on playing even when a little rascal is knocking her camera right over. It was a close thing. For the potter, something happens in the process of centering the clay. It's unmistakable. One moment, there's a bit of a wobble. Again, that feeling that the clay is resisting, pressing against one's hands and trying to knock them off their balance, off their center. And then, although the wheel is spinning and the sounds of the whir of the machinery and the splash of the water and the friction of the clay against one's hands are all there. There is this stillness, a stillness like silence, when suddenly under your hands, the clay is perfectly centered. Even in the midst of the spinning that helped make it possible, the still point of the turning world is right there. And at that moment of centering, the potter knows, now I can bring up the walls, I can make a vessel, I can make a vase that holds air and water. This is part of a series that we're doing on and off of exploring elements of the service. And this element of the service, where we have our centering, words and bell and silence, well, parts of it go way back to before my time. The bell was brought to be a regular part of our service by our previous parish minister, settled parish minister, Ken Collier. As I understand it, hearing about it secondhand largely, there was some bemusement when Ken started ringing a bell in the middle of the service. Why are we doing this? What is this all about? Now, this is a pretty hardcore humanist congregation. It's shifted and grown more diverse, and humanism in our congregation has opened up to be less allergic to ritual. But at the time, there was that sense of, why are we doing this strange thing that reeks of mysterious ritual in the middle of the service? But Ken stuck with it, we stuck with it, and when I came on board, it was just considered a regular part of the service, and so I continued it and enjoyed it very much. And it's revealing how this action that had been mysterious to people at first shifted over time. Because I remember, I don't know, a year or two, three into my time here, I was engaged in planning something. I think it was a big class with some members of the congregation, and we were talking about the need to bring people back into the center, into the main group after they'd been scattered around campus in small groups in the middle of this class, and talking about how we were going to do that. And I suggested, well, we could ring our bell. And there was this sort of startled response from the people I was planning with, and people said, no, we couldn't do that. The bell is for the service. Something had happened. It had become special. It had become sacred because of what happened there when we ring the bell in the service. These are often called meditation bells. That's a bit of a misnomer. They're Tibetan. They come from Tibet, but the Tibetans don't use them in their meditation practice, which goes back a very long way and is steeped in Buddhist and pre-Buddhist traditions. They don't call it a meditation bell, but I can see why that term kind of glommed on to these singing bowls. Because the experience that we have when we center there listening to the bell is a lot like meditation, like the meditation that we might practice sitting or walking in other traditions. So what happens? We ring the bell. I added that phrase of following the sound into silence because that's how it struck me, no pun intended, that this loud but melodious sound tapers off very gradually. And so it invites us to also go into a quieter and quieter and quieter space until we're in silence. And then, as Richard said, maybe we can hear what was underneath. Hear what was beneath not only the physical noises around us, but the noise within. As we come to stillness, we discover something. can see why we think of it as meditation. There's another piece of this ritual, of course, that's come along more recently, something that came out of early conversations between me and Dan Harper when he came on about a dozen years ago, that always thinking as an educator, he's our minister of religious education, he said he wanted something to happen in the service that reached the children, that was pedagogically a piece of education about our worship and our tradition. And the kids, when we all meet in person in the main hall, usually if they want to go to religious education, they go after 10 or 15 minutes. So all they were really hearing was announcements and greeting time. They were having our chalice lighting. They would leave after the ringing of the bell and then the first hymn. So all they really got was that chalice lighting and the first hymn of our tradition. And he said, can we have just a quote, just a very short reading for them to carry with them? Might fit with the theme, maybe it doesn't always have to, so that they understand what the adults are doing here before they go on their way. So we added these words. And maybe that's what people think about as they come to silence. I hope we'll talk about that. I'd like a continuation of this service. It feels like a wonderful opportunity. Would be for all of us to share in our breakout rooms after the service. What does a centering time mean to you? What role does it play in your hour here at church, in your week? It will be very interesting to hear that from one another. Now, in the Christian tradition, there's a kind of analogy to this experience, an annual one, and we're in it right now. It's called Advent, the four Sundays before Christmas, and there's a sort of slightly more secularized version, the counting down that begins on December 1st with a little Advent calendar, 24 days until one opens that last little window on Christmas morning. Whatever it is, whether it's practiced more secularly or religiously, the meaning is preparation for the coming of Jesus, for Christmas. Advent, a time of preparation like the potter preparing the clay to move into action. As M.C. Richard says, it's not about just stillness. It's not about being interior. It's a preparation that allows you to do the next thing, to widen out the clay, to make it live and have room for its purpose. A really interesting thing to me about this word Advent in this season of which Jan Richardson was speaking when she wrote her poem, her blessing for Advent, on the word prepare, is that Advent is kind of a redundant word. The root vent means to come. So to come is already an action with a direction. You can go away, you can go towards something, you can go in many directions. To come is always to move toward the speaker. Somebody is coming, they're coming toward this person who's speaking right now. And then the prefix ad is the prefix that means toward. So it's like toward, coming toward. Preparation for preparation, which of course is what Jesus' birth is a preparation, the beginning of the 33 years of his teaching. And it also echoes that fact that we are always preparing, that it needs to be done again and again, which is why Christians celebrate Advent and then Christmas every year. Over and over again, we prepare. And that's why we do this every week. We need to center and recenter. We get knocked off balance. We get knocked out of that stillness. And we stop being able to hear what is underneath all the noise of our own thoughts, the busyness of our time, our week. And potters are the same way, you know. You go to a potter's workshop and you'll see all the beautiful vessels there that have been completed and fired and glazed. But what you don't see is the dozens in between. In between each one, there might be many, many vessels that ended in just a lump of misshapen clay as the walls collapsed and they just had to be scraped off the wheel and turned into new clay and started again. Because they weren't properly centered. Over and over again, we practice centering. And so as we come together, maybe we come having had a pretty calm week, we come in a pretty calm and centered and ready frame of mind. Already physically, mentally, spiritually ready for whatever may unfold in this time together. Or maybe we come really roiled with the chaos of our thoughts, of our relationships, of our jobs, of what's happening out in the world, and that silence helps us come to that center. Either way, sometimes it's only when we center that we hear what was beneath. That we hear in the stillness something that had not been in our awareness before. And so the transformation begins. We do it again and again. We prepare again. We return again. We center again and again so that we can create a vessel for our lives. So may we do. We will now give and receive the offering that we hand on to our justice partner. So grateful for the work that California Clean Money Campaign does in our state, in our world, to enact our values, to bring the wider community closer to what we dream. The order of service gives a QR code and link and also information on using text to give via Give Lively. I hope you can support our justice partner generously.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please join in as Bruce leads us in singing, "Just as Long as I Have Breath." Tonight is the final night of the Festival of Hanukkah, and so as we extinguish our chalice, I'd like to share these words about Hanukkah by the Reverend Rachel Hayes. In a time that was long ago, in a time that is now, people find fuel and dare to set fire to it, knowing it cannot last. And sometimes it lasts. Sometimes it lasts. Take it with you and bring it back. Thank you. Please stay after the benediction for our virtual coffee time. You'll be invited to small group conversations in our breakout rooms, or you can stay here in the main room with me and Richard to discuss the service. Now, please unmute yourself, turn on your video if you're comfortable with that, and touch hands virtually like this, or put a hand on your heart and another out to others while we say our benediction together. Go out into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Rejoice in beauty. Speak love with word and deed. Honor all beings. Amen.